So what I plan to do is do a sort of a lecture demonstration of what I have done so far, and then we will be discussing, and I am sure as creators or mentors of creators, helpers of creators, of course, as you will have lot many questions. And I also have had these questions, but experience has given me some possible solutions and ways out. And again, I should emphasize that what I am going to present here is essentially a personal view of mine, a personal experience. There is nothing formal about it, and I am going to take you to the actual course site on EDX. I am taking you on EDX because that is a fully baked site. The course is live and is being used, so we'll even be able to see the discussions and other things in it. One sort of a disclaimer that although Swayam is supposed to be a clone, not exactly a clone, is based on EDX. The bifurcation took place a few months ago. After that, EDX site is getting updated. Swayam is getting modified for our own purpose. So the location of some switches, the options available in some options, or some variation of the options will exist. So just don't take a photograph of this and say the Swayam front end is slightly different. Whatever was left side here is now right side there, and such things will happen. But I think such things happen in almost all websites and other facilities we visit, and we get used to them. So coming to my experience, now why did I take this up? The answers are essentially there. So that is to reduce my verbal overload. But essentially the four answers, and first two are absolutely personal. When somebody asks me to do something, will you do it? And my usual answer is, why not? Okay. And that's how I got entangled with Professor Phatak some 25 years ago. I think the first major encounter was just after 1987, around 1990, I suppose. Professor Jagan Mohan was the chairman of JEE, and it was decided that JEE will be offered in N languages. Even the question papers will be available in N languages. I think after a year of experimentation, or some experimentation, it was decided that many languages will be accepted as answer book languages, but question papers will only be available in English and Hindi. But we did the first exercise of preparing glossaries and setting up procedures for translating formal question papers into other languages. I have another habit of, when asked to do something, I'll do it once with the best of my ability, and after that, if I like it and feel like doing it again, I'll do it again. If I don't like it or don't enjoy it for some purpose, I am then free to say that, look, I didn't say no when it was asked of me to do it, but I didn't like it, didn't enjoy it, so don't ask me to do it again. And that usually works, at least in the environment of IIT Bombay and a few other organizations with which I am involved, it has worked. And of course, there are personal links with Professor DBP. Right from my early days, he was here earlier than me on campus, but there were mutual friends. I think Nawathe was one of them, Bhavsar was another. Then some common things in teaching computer programming, particularly Fortran compilers and things like that, we work together. And the three dots represents an absolutely personal link. The other half of mine, Mrs. Gaitonde, works in this project. She started working with Professor Phatak soon after CRESIT was formally established, and then moved to the projects, and now she is the one who handles all the finances of all MHRD projects of Professor Phatak. And through her, I came to realize that for setting this project up, or the predecessor projects, a set of teams has been created so that the faculty members involved essentially have zero administrative overhead. And that was the one which attracted me, and that is the one which attracted others in this institute. And I am sure that would also be an attraction to faculty members in other institutes. Because science and technical faculty members and even other faculty members would loathe any administrative overload. A minor one which is part of your coursework and academic work is okay, but a major one like taking care of the travels and stay of people, taking care of their TA bills, etc., it's something which is absolutely no-no for faculty members. And that is something which is arranged by Professor Fatak and his big team of assistants and project managers and all that. I don't even know how many are there. Once in a while I hear numbers like 70, 170, 270. The first digit goes on changing. The last two digits generally remain 70 for some magic reason. In fact, this zero admin overhead is something which I first felt, experienced myself when I attempted a first NMEICT course on thermodynamics. And after having confirmed that, I advertised it, and that has attracted other faculty members, particularly from my own department, in offering courses. So that is something which is to be noted. And any one of you, whenever you create a setup in your institute where faculty members will provide their brainware, teaching abilities and all that, you have to create a setup where the administrative overload on a, or administrative load on a faculty member is as low as possible, preferably negligible. Now, why thermodynamics? Again, the reasons are there. It has been a personal favorite right from my student days at IIT Bombay. It became more of a favorite after my doctorate when I worked in BHEL for 3 years. After coming back here, I enjoyed teaching it to students. And among the students, I found teachers of other colleges who at that time came through the TTT scheme or QIP scheme for MTech and PhD. And when the CD, a Center for Distance Engineering Education program, was set up, and I think around that time NPTEL started. I don't know whether CD was created because NPTEL project was on, or it existed and hence it managed the NPTEL project. My thermo course ME209 was recorded by CD and it's available on the web in 2009, July, November. That was a change of attitudes, because after that I found that I started receiving queries from outside people who looked up those things and then said that, look, why restrict myself to students of IIT Bombay? I should formally expose my teaching to others. The opportunity came in the first NMEICT project, or what I call the first NMEICT project, that Teach a Thousand Teachers. I think started in 2009 or 2008. Initially, it was restricted to teaching of computer programming and other computer science subjects like databases and things like that. Last month, end of 2010 or so, it was extended, scope was modified, and Professor Fatak was told that don't restrict yourself to computer programming and databases, move out to other departments and other basic courses. And naturally, I was a willing guinea pig, so I offered to teach thermodynamics. It was called, the first version was called Thermodynamics in Mechanical Engineering, and that was implemented in 2011 June. The coordinators workshop for some 34 centers was conducted in February, 1 week, and then we had actual course over 2 weeks, that is 10 working days through ICT, that is using AVIEW and things like that, over the internet at 31 centers. 3 centers dropped out because one lost interest and two couldn't get enough participants, and that was a success with some, I think, 650 or 750 participants. And soon after that, other mechanical engineering courses were conducted by my colleagues. And roughly a year after that, that teach 1,000 teachers was scaled up to teach 10,000 teachers, so T10KT. And I think the very first in that was this second edition of thermodynamics. It was, I think, simply called engineering thermodynamics at that time. And that took place in 2012 December. I think there were 167 centers and something like 8,500 participants. And final two reasons are that, well, because it's a personal favorite, thermodynamics is my home ground. Very comfortable in teaching, discussing and solving problems with it. Even my industrial work and research work is around thermodynamics, applied thermodynamics. So a takeaway for you is whichever faculty teaches a course through this should be a confident faculty members, very comfortable in that course, because now questions and comments are going to come from all over India. And the last one, but very important one, is that if you depend only on one faculty member for teaching and managing that course, it's a dangerous thing. You don't have a backup. It's like something which is only on in the memory of your mobile phone. If that crashes or gets lost, you are totally lost. That shouldn't happen. There should be at least one, preferably two, almost equivalent backup faculty members. Okay. I will leave it to you to decide what is almost equivalent or what are good faculty members. But I have been very lucky in thermodynamics that over the years, initially I was the backup faculty for my teachers and other colleagues. And later on, even today for this course, I have two backup faculty members. One is Professor Upendra Bhandarkar, my own earlier student of the early 90s. But he is in Trivandrum for some project presentation. The other one is Professor Milind Atre. There was a question.
So based on your experience, a minimum number of faculty for a course?
See, minimal logically is one. But
you said it's dangerous.
It's dangerous. If something happens to you. For example, when I started recording, I planned to record approximately 2 months in advance of that particular week. And then there was some flu, sore throat, and I lost 3 weeks of recording.
Why I'm raising this question is because, for example, in an engineering college, you may have many faculties in a particular department.
Right.
We have very, we are resource constrained.
Yes, for small institutes, specialized institute, then the way out is, don't announce the course till everything is recorded, the whole structure is ready.
Okay.
And then, for example, that is what Professor Gadre is doing. For its signals and systems, there is absolutely no announcement.
So
only Professor Patak, and now you know that that course is likely to be offered. He has been recording off and on for the last 2 months. He will continue to record for maybe another month or 2 months at his own pace. After the whole thing is recorded, he will make the structure. Everything will be ready physically and electronically. And then it will be announced, and maybe 2 months later it will go live.
So based on your experience, how much time should it take for the whole course to be absolutely
I'll come to that. All that structure is being discussed.
Thank you.
Okay, including some nitty-gritty. Let me go through this about 10 slides, and after that it's essentially an open house and a demonstration. Now let me come to first preparation, operation, creation and all that. First thing is you have to announce the course, at least internally, if not externally. That is the commitment. We did internal commitment as well as external commitment almost simultaneously within a few weeks of each other. But you can do the course announcement, that is your own commitment, on Jan 1. Create everything ready maybe by April or something like that, your own time. Say if it takes 4 months for recording. A good idea is when you are teaching the course, you are fresh, you all have, you know, you are running lecture to lecture. So if you can detach yourself from other work for about 2 hours a day, give your lectures in the morning, in the afternoon, or even on the previous day, go to the studio and record those parts of the lectures which will go into that course. Then create an introductory video. This is required soon after, or at the time of announcing the course to the outside world. Yes, we will all share. Now I'll show you the.
My request is, can we get a CD of the entire workshop, all the recording that are being taking place?
Okay. I'll modify. Yes, it is yes.
Okay, thank you.
And the default is anything which happens related to these MHRD projects in the public domain, that means like this, gets recorded, whether we like it or not. All interactions are also recorded and are available on the NMEICT site. And generally, our site is well endowed. If your connecting links are good enough, there is absolutely no effort required in downloading it. But if you are in some very odd place where that thing, just request and we will send you a set of DVDs. CDs are now out because we do everything in HD mode, so the videos are long. And you have to create a team of colleagues and TAs to help you with all the technicalities of the course. This is not the admin part of recording, this is your own. And usually the colleagues are backup and sounding boards, and TAs are the ones who would do your sketching, problem solving, discussion modules, case study creation and all.
So the concept of TAs are prevailing in IITs, but in the university system there is no concept of TAs so far.
You will need, otherwise you will get overwhelmed. You will have to, TAs, RAs means student level assistance.
Yeah, so even RAs are not being advised to take the classes because they
They are not going to take classes.
Yeah.
But suppose you have a set of exercises.
Yeah.
You want model solutions to be created. They are the ones who will do it.
Any university which runs a postgraduate program will have research scholars and will have postgraduate students. It is my understanding that the entire amount of scholarship that used to be paid earlier to these people has been converted into what is called TA-ship. So there is no free scholarship available. People have to work for the money that they are paid monthly. Now, IIT system has evolved to use all of them very meaningfully as teaching assistants. That is how our courses run. Universities probably have not evolved that system. It's high time you did that. The research scholars who are working on an area related to that subject and the postgraduate students are absolutely excellent support system for running a course properly for doing these kind of. If you have not done that, I would suggest you start it immediately and let this be the starting point. That is one. It is possible that for some courses and in some universities you may not have such research scholars assignment. Please go ahead and employ people who are experts temporarily for a course. We have done that. I will describe the budget that you have, but without a support system, the faculty member who is the lead faculty member will kill himself or herself doing it. We have tried that also. We have experience of all kinds, and that is why what he is suggesting is the gist of all experiences, that you should have a team in place which will support the faculty. This is not the admin team. This is not the technical recording team, which I will describe the different budget heads, I think tomorrow afternoon session, as to how much budget has been allocated. And I have the clearance from Joint Secretary to actually announce it, to tell you what will be the total budget available for this project for 3 years. So there is a budget. Now how judiciously you use that budget is your call. For example, we have provided for up to 10 teaching assistants for running a course. Now this is an average budget. If there is a course which has 1 lakh students attending, you may require more than 10. If there is a course with only 10,000 students attending, you may do with only 4. But you will need people. That is the only thing that the faculty member keeps attending to it with full academic energy. And I will, sorry for taking some time, but I would re-endorse very strongly the point that he mentioned. A faculty member who teaches a course, both the lead faculty member and other faculty members, we are primarily tapping their intellectual prowess, their experience and their expertise in academic area. If they have to draft and sign and send as much as one letter during the entire course, I think we have not fulfilled our duty. That is exactly what he means by zero overheads to the faculty. A faculty member as in any other place in IIT, is a very, very important contributor academic. Now, it is true that many of faculty members, all of us have to work as deans, as heads, etc. When we do that, we undertake that administrative responsibility. But in this particular task of creating a course, we are tapping only the academic resource. So in our case, what he says is correct. I mean, we have this workshop team. So when he conducts a T10KT workshop, he never gets a letter from any participant saying, my accommodation is not proper or something like that. I get that letter, or my team gets that letter. And we are supposed to solve that problem, not him. But he will come, and that is the reason why he is fresh. He can spare 2 hours a day, every day, to think about this. He can spare 1 hour in the evening to record his 10-minute, 15-minute clip. He can ponder over that material. He can go over that material with his colleagues, TAs and others, and make that perfect. Because that is what counts. That is what will go to 1 lakh students, not his administrative ability to write letters. He can do that. So that I would emphasize again, that you must create, and that is the reason why we have provided for an adequate staff provision. You have to employ these staff and you have to put them in place. And you have to tell them that the faculty member and the TAs will not do any administrative. Because many places, I know it used to obtain even here 30, 40 years ago, we have changed over the years. A clerk in the academic office will expect a student to come to him to inquire about something. Clerk does not consider it his or her responsibility to proactively hunt out the student and inform that student that this is what you have to do. I mean, this is how we have structured ourselves thanks to the British legacy. But I think it is time to change all of that. So in computer science department, for example, if a new faculty member joins, before the faculty member comes into the office on the joining date, the office, the furniture, the PC, the telephone and the email ID is all ready. If it is not ready, some person in the office will have to pay for it. That is the process that we have established over 10 years of experience and working. Now, this may be going too far, but what I am saying is that this absolute freedom to the faculty and the TA group to concentrate on academic matters is essential. That is one. Secondly, when he says 2 months or 3 months, and when I also said that it will take 2 to 3 months, it does not always mean 2 to 3 months of full-time work for the faculty. But it means 2 to 3 months of peaceful work for the faculty. Maybe few hours here, few hours there, etc., etc. But every day, those people should concentrate on the academy. Second thing, he has been emphasizing the recording, which is the main crux of the course. But that is not the only thing, as I mentioned. There are several other things like problems, etc., which are to be studied.
So the basic backup that we have to ensure at our end, we can't possibly have the whole team or the
all employee. We want is a commitment, right?
No, announcement
of a course.
So that's too tight a bit.
What he described is what we call the dynamic stability. When the system achieves dynamic stability, which will be a luxury that we will have next year, that is when you start announcing courses after more or less the course is complete. Unfortunately, we do not have that luxury as of 17th. So as of this 17th, you will have to, that is the reason why there were many people who said we have 10 courses ready, we can work on them, 15 courses, etc., etc. Please don't be that adventurous. But you have to be a little adventurous. And you have to say, we believe that with these inputs, our course will be ready in 5 months' time. We believe that. And you believing it is not sufficient, the faculty member, the lead faculty member must also so believe. Now, if I am the lead faculty member and you ask me to make a commitment on 17th, I may answer variously. I may say, no, not at all. In which case, it will be prudent for you to say we cannot announce a course. I may say, I will do it, but it may take 3 to 4 months. It will be prudent for you to add one more month and announce the starting date as 1 month beyond whatever the faculty member is coming. But once you make that commitment, it is up to you and the faculty member to fulfill that commitment. Now, what may happen is that when you announce the course on 17th, and I mean tell us to announce and we announce it on 25th, the introductory video may not be there, which is perfectly fine. But the introduction to the course as a content page can definitely be constructed in 2 days. And that's all we need now. You see, the problem is twofold. One is urgent action required. Second is a stable period and stable operations. So what Professor Gayatunde has been describing is a stable portion. But he did not tell you that when the first time he did that, he made the commitment without batting an eyelash. And there's no preparation, no nothing. Now, we are at the starting point of the national rollout, and that is why this is an extra request that is being made by the ministry to all participating universities. That do dare. What will happen in the worst case? Let me discuss. I mean, as an engineer, worst case, best case is what I always think. Best case is you prepare that course actually in only 2 months instead of 4 months. The course will start later. Fine, the faculty member and the group get some respite, they can enjoy for some more time. Worst case, the course does not get ready by that. But let's say you have announced the course date starting as 4 months from today, from 25th, and about 3 months later you realize that there are 25,000 students who have registered, but the course is not ready. Now you can take a call in the following fashion. You can say how much portion of the course is ready. So suppose it's a 14-week course, which was supposed to start in November. And suppose 4 to 5 weeks course material is completely ready, another 5 weeks in the offing. There's absolutely no harm in starting the course, because the weeks will roll out. We have done that, by the way, when we did the EDX course. We announced the course without preparing. And he is much ahead, as I told you yesterday. I and Supratik are struggling to keep just 2 weeks ahead of the course. It's doable, but it's very stressful. Now somehow, I have been trained by Professor Isaac to work 24 hours a day for at least 3 days in a week. That was the training. Not everybody would have been trained like that. We don't expect that to happen. But it will mean that people who have to do such courses, while the course is running, they may also be recording for some future week. Another reason why you should have a team. So that when the course runs under such extreme circumstances, the course starts running because you have only 2 months of material ready, but 2 more months of material is yet to be ready. So this is a call that we'll all have to take. I am suggesting that if your institute is able to set up the back-end infrastructure within the next 4 months, I think there is no danger. And what will happen out of 25 courses which are announced by the national mission? Let us say we have the ignominy of saying, sorry folks, you have registered, but this course will not start now. It will start 3 months later. We are postponing it. Does that not happen day in and day out in our universities? Yeah. But that is the worst case, madam. That is not what we should aim for. That's all. I think we should aim for getting at least one or two courses that we promise ready by that time. And the time is available. I think the JS mentioned it, I will repeat it again. This assurance has been made by the HRM on the floor of the house. Now that is the most solemn assurance that a nation can be given, that this will start. Now there is therefore no going back. All that we are doing is we are trying to honor a commitment made to the people of the country. Now to the best possible extent we'll do it. We'll simultaneously achieve stability in our teams over a period of 6 months, 8 months, 1 year. So from next year onwards, this will not be a problem. Secondly, all of you would get first-hand experience in doing. In fact, one of the reasons on my suggesting that the model of this short workshop should be a lot of hands-on. Actually, it's not going to make you experts. But I believe even that half a day that you spent yesterday, you got a glimpse of what is required, what is involved. Now you can expand on it. All of you are experienced people. And of course, we will arrange more such workshops, that the participants, the TAs, etc., who come, will arrange specific workshops for them over the next month, 2 months, etc. That's not a problem. So, two parts. One, what we have to do on 17th. The other, what he's describing, is what we ought to do going forward. Sorry for taking time, but I thought they will be delighted to say that I don't have to commit anything now. that is not the case. And I will tell you from my own experience of visiting n number of institutions and universities, you will always find one or two faculty members who will say, chalo karke dekhte. So that is another criteria you should add for selecting a course. The courses should not be nominated, in my opinion, by others. You should actually have a judgment on the people who are teaching that course, how well known they are, how well reputed they are, how their courses are perceived by the students. And last but not the least, how many maximum number of students are likely to benefit. In the worst case, I would think that if you believe that there is a specialized course, which is your signature course, but it is not likely to benefit more than 20,000 students across the country, no problem. But it is that course by which the world will recognize you when you offer that course to people. So that is also an important point. Yeah. So
another thing to note is any institute, whenever it offers a course, it generally is not true that there is only one faculty member, because just assume that something happens to that faculty member. What happens to that course halfway through? The university has a backup, maybe a dormant backup or a sleeping backup or whatever, but that backup is necessary. And it's like this, it's like a sleeping backup may take about a week, 2 weeks to come on board, because he or she just doesn't even realize that he or she is a backup. Just to reduce this change over time, if at all it is necessary, keep the backup in the loop, that's it. So the backup just knows that something like this is happening and I may have to step in. The moment he knows, he keeps himself aware of what is happening, and then this change over time, if at all is required, is reduced, that's all. So continuing with the preparation, essentially this is written from thermodynamics or a typical mechanical engineering or engineering course. But I think whatever be the type of course, even from the social sciences, this part and this part is going to be there. You may or may not have slides, you may or may not have animations and videos. Instead of exercises, you may have exercises in a general sense, some assignment, some homework, something. So this will also be there, but maybe in some different ways. These two could be replaced as appropriate for that particular course. Now this is something, up to this it was essentially, the previous slide was your own course that you will do anyway, whichever mode the course is implemented in. Now we have to fit it to the MOOCs, which is the Swayam structure, which is currently at least is based essentially on the EDX structure. And here the structure is at four levels: section, subsection, unit and subunit. Now here my experience is this subunit is a bit too much of a detail, and I think I am able to manage my course just at section, subsection and unit level. In fact, I found that when you have a number of subunits, the subunits, at least in the current web front end, are managed one below the other. And a student tends to look at only the top part and does not scroll down. So some students have missed the second and third video, and later on when they came to the quiz, they said, oh, you never taught this, and other people said, why didn't you scroll down and see? And I had to send out a note showing a snippet saying that, look, there is a notice here, indirect or direct, that there are more than one videos or more than one this thing. But in principle, everything is arrangeable, could be arranged in 4 weeks. I think all of you have this, and I have said may change because EDX is evolving, Swayam will definitely evolve. So this is what the structure is, and this is the way the structure looks on the actual web page, as I will show you. The course is one particular subject or one particular paper, as people say. S1, S2, S3, S4 are the various sections. Each section will have one or more subsections, and each subsections will have units. I showed it horizontally because on the website you will see them horizontally. And within every unit, there are the fourth level is the subunit, which will again be arranged vertically without you being conscious of it, because a list is not provided. It's just on that web page, one below the other. For example, this slide is 16 by 9 and I go to the next slide. But instead of that, I could have made this slide in a bigger thing, shown you just the top half. Now, if you don't know that there is a bottom half, you will not scroll down. You will just go to the next slide. And that is what happens with the current design of the subunits. So, my recommendation, this is what I learned the hard way while implementing the course, that as far as possible, do not use subunits. But if you use, at the beginning, provide a hint that there are subunits.
There is one place where we have found that the subunits are absolutely useful. That is, whenever you give a graded quiz or a graded exam, let's say weekly exam, and you have, let's say, 10 questions of 2 marks each. Now, those 10 questions of 2 marks each together will count to a 20 marks quiz. And you might be arranging such quiz every week. Now, when you arrange a quiz every week, then at the end of, say, 10 weeks, you might announce that best 7 out of 10 will be considered for your score. So, these are called droppable quizzes. Now, you can drop an entire quiz based on the lowest score. That the system does automatically, provided that quiz is available as a single entity. So all those 10 questions for 20 marks must appear one below the other. Each individual question can be constructed as a subunit so that you can replace or rephrase in case there is a mistake in the wording or whatever it is. You can replace one question from a quiz. But it is useful to put all these 10 questions as 10 subunits and mention in the unit head that this is a weekly graded quiz which contains 10 questions all listed one after another below. As he said, and by the way, when there is a graded quiz and I know that there are going to be 10 questions, there is no way I will miss out scrolling down. So that is one place where there is no danger of people missing out. But if you keep these as separate units, then the calculation of the total score becomes extremely difficult, because a weekly quiz, preferably a droppable quiz, is a good idea for scoring people. People will score poorly or well in some quizzes. We do that. I do not know what the university system is, but in IIT, of course, every faculty member decides one's own grading system. So that's a freedom that we have. But it is universally true that most faculty members will either give a makeup test or a quiz, or will say, out of these 10 assignments, we will take the best 7 marks or something. Now, that is a recommended approach for online courses, and subunits will help there. Sorry, I digress, but this was important, because when you construct a quiz, a single quiz with so many questions, coming out as subunits is best. If they are different units, then replacement, totaling, etc., which is done automatically by the system, gets weird. This I learned from Brinda very recently after making the mistake, which I am suggesting you don't make. Yeah, please. Yes.
So this is in context of the structure that you are suggesting for the course. I can foresee that some people might be more comfortable writing out the text to themselves once, and then they would like that content to be straight away ported to the online forum. So is there some way we can pipe, say, structured documents like a LaTeX document or HTML document directly to?
Yes, that's you can. See, anything which you can put on a computer screen, either through a camera or by any other method, is capturable. I think one should remember that if you can, anything which can come onto a screen is capturable.
No, but I was thinking more in terms of, you know, if I'm planning a course, I break up my units into what I feel are logical units or length which I am comfortable with, and I write out a document, some kind of a script to my video to myself, and then I don't want to go through the extra effort of coding this into the final format. So it is that kind of a document I'm
talking about. See, in the simplest case, suppose you have a document, you can simply scan it and import it. Otherwise, if your handwriting is good, do that. In fact, that would be excellent, because a good handwriting is much easier and comfortable to read than any font ever.
The facility which you may not have explored, but just as you have a facility to upload a file, that is exactly how you integrate videos and others. You can upload a PDF file, you can upload a scanned image, JPEG file, and in the text in the course, you can say, this particular document is found here, and you can actually give a link. So in any document as part of the course, if a student clicks on that, that particular document which you have uploaded, that will come and become.
You will see illustrations when I come to my course.
Yeah.
Most of these things are there. Now, after having said so about these subunits, remember that subunits do have a place, and it's possible for some courses. For example, I can imagine a course where at the top there is some discourse, either a video or maybe a stanza of a poem or a part, and below that is the place for discussion or even a quiz. So once you start having a design of a particular kind, then the students will expect that sort of a design, and if you repeat it, then there is no harm. But all I am saying is these four levels are a four level facility provided to you. To what extent you use each of these four levels is left to you. And although the EDX says that a section is a week, just look at it as level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4. This weekly thing is only from the point of view of a timetabling, time-based. But you can always have a section as a lecture, a subsection as a video, and a unit as something else. It is absolutely left to you. Don't go by their week lecture and other things. If you want to make section as a lecture, so be it. If you want us to make a section as a topic which occupies maybe 2.5 weeks or 3 weeks, so be it. It's left to you. These are just four levels available. Then here in a MOOC, since we don't have to worry about availability of classrooms, whether it is convenient to me, convenient to students to attend a quiz, here the quizzes can be inserted anywhere. So we should use this facility to provide maybe small quizzes after every section or subsection, or weekly quizzes. The design is left to you. But that is a conscious decision one has to take. My thermo experience has been, in the first week I provided quizzes after every lecture. I think the first week had some 3 lectures. And the quizzes were available on day 1 at time 0. And what I found is smart Alex, he said, oh, I know everything of thermodynamics, let me go straight to the quiz. And he goes to some quiz, maybe the 3rd quiz in that week. And then he misses out on all the structure, the introductory things, the terminology which is properly defined. And says, oh, your question is meaningless, your question is wrong. Such comments started coming within minutes of releasing that. Now, even the first video, which is maybe 4 minutes, you have not completed, and you have started commenting on the quiz. So after, I think, 1 week or 2 weeks of this, my structure has been release the material on Tuesday at 12 noon, our time. But the quiz will be released on Friday noon of the same week. The deadline is still 10 days away, so the issue is not with the deadline. The deadline is left to you. And immediately I found that the discussion moved away from immediate discussion on quiz questions to discussion on the contents of the course. And when the quizzes came, the comments on that were much more mature than those unbaked comments which I got on the first one. So this is also something which you have to take care of. Yes, sir.
Sir, I am Dr. Kusuma from Mass Communication, Jamia Millia. I wanted to know, do you also give us some kind of grading system which is,
yes,
universal?
Not
in terms
universal.
Of, all the courses, or is it?
No,
like
there is no hardwired grading system. Initially, when you set up the course structure, you say how many grades you have. That is the EDX and the current SWAYAM structure. As we evolve, it will definitely change as required. You have to say that first is what is the passing level. So you can say 50%. You can say 60%, you can say 40%, the slider can be moved from near 0 to near 100. Then in the passing level, you have to decide how many grades. It could simply be one grade, in which case it's pass or fail. Or it could be two grades, in which case it is A, B and fail.
And in terms
three grades, in which case it is A, B, C. For example, in thermodynamics, I think we have said 50% is the passing grade, 50 to 70 is C grade, 70 to 85 is B grade, above 85 is A grade. But these partitions are sliders, like the widths of a spreadsheet. You can always go there and move them back and forth.
Like these quizzes, I did a course last year, this Amsterdam University's Introduction to Communication. Like they used to give twice you can repeat this quiz.
Yes, those the and number of attempts can also be set.
Can also be.
But you know, there is something like true or false. You should give only one attempt.
Right.
Because if you give two attempts, everybody will get them right. So you have to be careful in giving the number of attempts. Suppose if you have one out of four correct, then I think more than two attempts is meaningless. Because the moment you provide four attempts, everybody is going to get. Now, this is now we are getting into some technicalities. The first one is really technical. We want to provide a transcript. It is possible in some courses that you first create a transcript, then essentially say that. Of course, you may say slightly different, in which case you only have to edit a transcript. I attempted to do that, but immediately gave up. Because what I write and what I say is essentially the same thing, but not as read out there. Okay, I have this habit of not stopping my thinking process even while recording. That's a disadvantage. I should be able to switch off that and or maybe create a script and get some, you know, maybe a professional presenter to do this. One person specified that, look, if you want 100,000 people to register for your thermodynamics, somehow get Amitabh Bachchan to present it for you. You just give him the scripts and all that. But that's not. We are in the teaching business. We are not in the acting and presenting business. So I think without saying so, everybody would agree that the one who teaches in class should be the one who presents it. Then you have to work with your, so these are the technical and admin team, not much of an admin here I suppose, or if there is an admin that is absolutely transparent, I don't even see that. So you have to match wavelengths with the studio team and MOOC lab team, because we depend on them. Okay. So get used to working with them, their timing, their frequency of way of thinking, etc. And make life comfortable for them, also for you. The transcription software, we use something called Dragon, maybe there are competing products available. There are some question marks here. For example, in my case, I trained the Dragon. The Dragon is a computer program. It starts off by giving you some 5 pages of text to read. It takes about 45 minutes. And then it knows what that text is, so it matches your, you know, style of speaking and all the all phonetic characteristics with it. Then it, I think the second part of the training is you create your own passages. If you are teaching thermodynamics, read out something from a thermodynamics book and make that available as a text to it, correct it, what it does. So, and then every time your recorded audio file is given to it, it will convert it into a text file. Our job is to correct that text file and provide it back to Dragon so that it keeps on learning. I found that in the first week, the transcription was not that good, but second, third week onwards, it has really improved. So I hope the software is really improved. But then I find that one of the other colleagues who is working with me, Dragon has not been able to make sense of his speech. Whereas the third colleague, it seems, is okay. So, there are still some issues. And Dragon is essentially made for the Western accent, not the Indian type of.
No, sir, actually, I've used it. We need to train the Dragon actually.
Yes, but then pronunciation, it understands even after training well. But some people, for some reason, it doesn't. And I don't know why, I don't know the innards of Dragon.
Can I ask a small question?
Yes, sure.
When you do the video recording right. And the teacher lectures and you have a transcript and say the lecture is from a textbook or an article, and when you actually transcribe that, does it then violate copyright or?
Now, if you are suggesting that there is a teacher who actually reads the textbook as a part of the course teaching.
I'm saying if that happens.
If that happens, please change the teacher.
I
have not seen any teacher who will repeat verbatim whatever is stated in
that. Absolutely. No, that is probably is unlikely. But, you know, there could be some overlaps.
No, but if there is an overlap, when you say transcription, the transcription does not appear as a separate document. The transcription appears as subtitles in the movie. So in the video of the teacher,
right.
The subtitles will appear there. You might have seen some videos.
Yes, yes.
That's the only place where the transcription appears.
Right.
The transcription is never to be given as an independent course material.
Right.
If a course material has to be published on the page which gives the gist of that lecture, then it has to be reworded and rewritten.
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay, thanks.
And at least for my course on thermodynamics, the transcript is, and I think for any transcript, only the characters which are available on a standard keyboard are accepted. So subscripts, superscripts are out. So when I say the system goes from a state 1 with temperature T subscript 1, pressure P subscript 1, or I say T1 P1 with bracket open T subscript 1 comma P subscript 1 bracket closed. Brackets don't come there. This says let the state transit from an initial state T1 P1. So initial state space T space 1, that type of a thing comes. Okay, so if somebody reads the transcript without looking at the video, lost. So partial derivatives, integral, everything is all fudged in the transcript. Beta is written as BETA. Theta is written as THETA. Even if you have a technical typewriter, that is not allowed. A standard typewriter, capital A to Z, lowercase a to Z, and whatever you see, 0 to 9 and all those hash, at, exclamation mark, comma, code, that's it. Whatever you see on an ordinary keyboard, no special character at all. That is a requirement in transcript. Now, if you are teaching philosophy or English literature or something like that, it doesn't matter. Because hardly any special characters come up. But in technical thing, for example, if you provide a course in real analysis, the reading through the transcript would really be fun. Even a mathematician may not be able to understand it. So now your own backup support, that is TAs, you have to get on board, if required, train them. In my case, I am lucky, I have excellent students at the undergraduate and postgraduate level. So I just grabbed them. In fact, I got too many, I had to say no to quite a few. Okay. But then again, you have to have a sort of a narrowed initially and then wider later type of a network. You should be able to talk, talking only to one or two TAs, the lead ones, the leaders of the pack of TAs. They in turn should be talking to others. Because you should not be overwhelmed by queries from 12 people at a time. All those queries should be filtered by the senior TA or senior TAs. We just have two of them for thermodynamics. And if you have to prepare any specific type of documents, prepare them. For example, thermodynamics, we prepared steam tables based on the open steam tables available from NIST. We had to reformat and reconvert them because some, for example, thermal energy was not listed. Specific volumes were not listed, densities were listed. So we just had to re-edit them according to our need.
More on the subject, because as you said that you are teaching thermodynamics for engineering students.
Right.
thermodynamics used to be taught to the chemistry students.
To?
Chemistry students.
Yes.
Thermodynamics used to be taught to the physics students.
Yes.
The way of thermodynamics knowledge transfer is entirely different.
Agree, perfectly agree.
But the content, basic philosophy of the thermodynamics remains the same.
Right.
So, whenever you are targeting the audience for the thermodynamics, are you targeting the audience whether they are...
I am targeting audience which are first engineers and then mechanical engineers. That is why the name of the course remains ME209X, because that's the...
So, let me add one more thing. It's an important question. We are not expected to create new courses for the general population of the country. This entire effort to take the best courses that we currently teach in our universities and to make them available to students, that is the limited endeavor. There is, of course, a lot of merit in saying that some common themes which are required across fields or across domains should be done. That will happen in due course of time. In fact, there is one more thing which I had stated, but it was not emphatically stated perhaps. I mentioned that there is a move for recognition of the course credits eventually by the students who take the MOOC courses. There cannot be any credits associated with a course if the course that I am offering is not one of the regular running courses of my universities, which has a credit or marks associated with that paper and defined. Now, once you do that, whatever be the intent of that particular paper or subject as it is taught, becomes the intent available to everybody. Those who will benefit from that intent are welcome to attend. Others may join for partially benefiting, but that is not our concern. Our concern is that our statement to the public is that the best courses from Indian universities will be made available to students. So, for example, that's why what he said is very important. It is ME209. There could be a CH209, where a chemical engineer who thinks differently from him about how thermodynamics should be talked about would be teaching that. If that course is offered, most probably many mechanical engineers across the country may not take it. Some may take it to benefit, but many chemical engineers. So be it. And that is one of the reasons why we are saying that preferably select a course which is likely to appeal to maximum number of people, but the course should be taught exactly the way that you teach it. In fact, that is your expertise. And you should announce, along with the course, you should announce the structure of that paper in your own university. Not every university may give credits. Some may have marks for the paper or whatever. So you should say, this is the subject which is taught. It has whatever, 100 marks. And it's typically, when it is taught in the university, the evaluation or assessment comprises of one mid-semester, one end-semester, two tests or whatever. For the benefit of the MOOC students, this has been mapped onto this. But if effectively if it's a 100-mark paper, and if your student getting 78 marks qualifies to get an honors, then a MOOC student getting 78 marks out of 100 should definitely be considered equivalent to be an honors. So there is expected to be a corresponding match between how these students will be assessed, because for those students, even though they may get an honor grade now, but they will get a grade. So for example, in our courses, we have announced, both of us, that the evaluation will be like this, and depending upon the marks that you score out of total 100, weightages have been given. Say for example, in my course, in order to pass, you must score minimum 40% marks. Then we have defined A grade, B grade, C grade, D grade, E grade, like that, which is in consonance with the kind of grading that I would do for my CS101 course. Unfortunately, in IIT system, another teacher who teaches CS101 next year might change the grading pattern. That is the academic freedom that we have. That is the reason why when a course is created and offered, it has a tag of two important components, the name of the university and name of the teacher. The lead faculty member and the team of faculty members would be remembered, would be tagged to that course. That is the course offered by them. Because even in the university, the syllabus may change later, whatever. But we are not talking of creating a new course for general public interest. we are talking about offering a course. Probably CEC will be the only exception where CEC does not really teach courses, not being a university. But it is preferable if they also pick up a course which is being adapted by someone for teaching, which is being used by someone for teaching. So it is very important that credits be associated with a course. They should be defined and described in the introduction. So basically we say, when this course is taught in IIT Bombay, it has whatever, 6 credits, it has so many lecture hours, so many whatever work hours, and you are expected to spend so much time. So that is, it is not immediately relevant. What will people do with 100 mark paper here and a 6 grade course there and a 8 grade course there? But eventually, when the country moves towards the recognition of these credits across universities, which is the fond hope, then that time, these kind of nominations.
My question is in 2 parts. The first part is, are credits foreseen right at the launch? And credits, or at least some evaluation, is it foreseen right at the launching time? And the second is, if this is going to be done, would it be a good idea to simply convert all of them to a standard normal distribution and divide, and make the grades on the basis of that?
So I will take his second suggestion first. Would it be a good idea to convert everything into some common structure? Unfortunately, you and I and all the people here have neither the competence nor the authority to do so. This is a matter that will have to be decided by the larger university system across the country. This is being debated in many nations. It is not that all nations have these things. Only United States has succeeded in setting up an independent organization which defines credit equivalence for each and every course that is taught by a university, provided university goes to that agency and says, give me the equivalence. In fact, Professor Pradeep Verma pointed this out to me. And this is so well done because in the United States, students often do some courses in one university and they go to some other university. And now that university has to decide how many of these credits are to be accepted, what is the equivalence. So invariably, they go to this agency and say, tell us the equivalence. And they tell you the equivalence and then you adopt that. In our university system, each university has a body which examines every such transfer request. So it is not uncommon, for example, for Bombay University to say that this student from Calcutta who has done BCom second year there and is coming to BCom third year here, there is such a body which is the chief controller of examinations or the board of studies or whatever. This body examines the courses completed by that student, compares those with the courses which were detailed for BCom first year and second year in Mumbai University, and we'll say out of these 15 courses that you have done, 13 we accept, these 2 you will have to do again, but you are admitted to BCom third year. In the BCom third year, one course which is running here now, you have done it in BCom second year there, we accept that. Now this equivalence is actually established in individual cases as per the current universities. What he is talking about is generalizing this across. We all hope that it will happen now.
My experience with this normal distributions is not good at all. So I taught courses at IIT, and of course the class size that time was small. When I was teaching, So I think if the course becomes very large, then it can go to normalcy. I have taught a 60-person course, electromagnetic fields. I often used to get bimodal distribution. There were a lot of people around 40, 50, and then there were a lot of people around 70, 80. So, I mean, if you get a bimodal distribution, then it's all gone, basically. Yeah, so I don't think.
In fact, we have a new rule for grading for large courses, where we have 500 students and so on. When you have 500 students, actually the distribution is not as skewed as you think. And we have a very simple rule. The teacher decides the A grade and the pass grade. The pass grade is required to be announced by the teacher ahead of time in terms of marks, but the teacher may marginally reduce it if he examines the borderline cases and thinks that there is enough evidence for the student to have known the minimum required. So for example, I have announced 40, but I have the freedom to say, all right, 37 will also pass. But once I decide that 37 is the passing grade, and I decide, let's say, 86 as A grade, then everything else is automatic. I'm supposed to draw a straight line. divide the number of grades, and whatever is that point, that becomes AB, BB, BC, CD, etc. And it is not uncommon to find people losing a grade or making a grade by 0.5 marks. Whereas when you have less number of students, you can study the distribution, look at the break points, and say, this is the point where there are two students with almost 3 marks difference. I will give that fellow a BB and this fellow a BC. This luxury again is not available for large courses. And for the MOOCs courses, I would strongly recommend use a linear structure where you define upfront that this will be the course grade. Again, this is the stable system. Starting now, it is not necessary for you to define your grading system at the point of announcement. But it should be announced preferably about 2 weeks before this. Total credits or total marks which are typically allocated in your own university for that paper should, however, be announced, because that is public knowledge information. And that is how people will do it.
I think if it comes to simply honor of completing a course or not completing a course, I can understand. But I think in a MOOC kind of situation, when you start giving grades, something like 85, the whole question of honor comes into picture. When I complete a course, a quiz,
no,
am I taking assistance from somebody else? In, you know, so I don't know how that is going to be resolved.
See, in my opinion, and particularly the way I look at the scores which are coming up in my thermo course, I find that I should not use the proper Hindi four-letter word for this, which is used in advertisements. But there is absolutely no meaning in the grades which you get online for these courses. Okay. So the best thing is the blended mode, where the teaching is and resources are available online. Maybe these quizzes, etc., you take as practice quizzes. But the actual evaluation for grading purpose is done locally by appropriate local authority.
So, by the way, let me clarify. He is referring to only one aspect, which is heavy discussion on the discussion forum, which gives away clues to the quizzes. But he is not talking about people being dishonorable. That is not seen by either of us. In fact, if you see the total number of students who attempt those quizzes, a large number of people don't, actually. The total number of people who attempt quizzes or questions are much fewer. This is one of the reasons why you say that there is a dropout rate, so many people don't complete it. If a large number of people were dishonorable, everybody would complete. That does not happen. Honor code is by and large respected. That is our observation. Honor code is by and large respected. How much credence you would like to give to the marks code for an actual credit transfer was the question. But as I mentioned yesterday, I do not see any which way that a university will automatically accept a MOOC's credit as the credit for my university accept. There is no way. The only way is there is at least a supervision of an examination where the examination is conducted at a fixed time and not open for 1 week. Now, when you run a course online, your primary objective is to benefit a large number of people from learning. The grade is incidental on the pure MOOCs kind of. But when people want to take MOOCs courses for the purpose of gaining credit, which is recognizable, obviously there will have to be other aspects. I have not circulated my blended MOOCs paper to you, but an important aspect of recognition of such grades is proctoring or supervision of all online evaluations by people. When we run a blended mode in CS 101, that is what we do. When students appear for online quizzes, they are supervised. And they are fixed time quizzes. A 20-minute quiz, which is laid out at 8 o'clock, stops at 8:20. I can share with you a very unique experience that we had. When we said we will conduct a back-to-back test, because we had more students and number of computers. And back-to-back test means I don't have to change the quiz paper, because one set of students goes out of the lab, the other student comes in. There is hardly any time for people to discuss. With that assumption, we started a back-to-back quiz. First time it worked well. Second time we uncannily found that the second batch had too many right answers. And that is because when the first quiz was announced starting from 8, It was visible everywhere on the internet. So several students in the hostel had actually seen that quiz before they came for the second batch. So it is what one facility which we desperately require in the MOOCs platform is to ensure that we can make a portion open not to general public but to a selected group. Now that is almost impossible because the current structure is all people are equal, all people are students. So these are some of the problems. Yeah.
Yeah, my question is slightly different. It's with regard to the pedagogy that we use for a particular course. For example, for us in a course, the pedagogy can be a mix of some lectures and, for example, case discussions. The entire class may be on a discussion of a case. So is that kind of a pedagogy possible for a course on MOOCs?
It is possible provided you announce a discussion and the discussion is moderated through discussion forum. And you say that next 3 days this matter will be open for discussion, people will make discussion points and you then have to give a concluding thought on that discussion. It's not as easy because this is not face to face. Please understand that there is nothing synchronous possible on this.
Yes, sir.
Everything will be asynchronous. Now the pedagogy that you mentioned has evolved because of our assumption that we are teaching a set of people who are physically here. We will have to think of adopting that pedagogy differently. Many of the current thinking in teaching and learning are changing as we adopt an asynchronous philosophy. That is one of the reasons why I believe that blended mode, we have to break.